want to welcome all of our listeners to the podcast that discusses all things gaming, coming to you from the home of Gen Con 2012 and the gaming capital of the world. This is The Established Facts. I am your interim host, Big Don, and without further ado, we'll get right into our introductions, starting to my right.
This is Rygar, and I'd also like to invite our viewers. We have Derek over here.
Live via satellite / camera.
Skype.
Skype, yeah, I guess Skype.
Hi, guys, this is Derek.
See, I wasn't sure we were actually going to talk or not. Were you specifically waiting for Jeremy to say your name or something?
I was specifically waiting for someone to cue me.
Oh, okay, so. Got it. Fair enough. You've been cued.
Why, thank you. Now back to you.
It's starting out.
It's a great start, right?
Yeah.
This is Josh, everybody.
And this is Anton.
Did everybody take their Ritalin this morning?
No.
No, I'm assuming not.
Sorry, I was wondering why I couldn't get rid of the Twitch.
Good Lord.
Oh. I was supposed to take Ritalin, not Coke?
Okay. Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. I drank a Monster. That's probably
it's the yellow pills, not the white powder.
No. That's powder on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and it's the yellow pill Monday, Wednesday, Friday.
Oh, I guess it is.
Or the
hello.
That's your good. Okay. It was me.
That was weird.
I know.
I just got a lot quieter in my ears.
Yeah. Well, you're a little loud on here, so I was fixing it.
Okay. Cool.
Well, live.
As long as you're okay.
Live mixing.
No, you're good.
Live mixing.
I just wasn't.
Well, you got to think. Not very many podcasts actually will sit here and mix while they're going, but you know, this is because we like to make it individual and personal.
Right. And back to you, Don.
Yeah.
Mike isn't here.
Yeah, I know, right?
And thank you for using Colgate. What?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. We're ready to sell a commercial.
How is everybody?
I'm good.
Yeah.
Everybody
fine.
Good?
Yeah.
I can't complain. I am still breathing.
That's good. Any day above the ground is a good day, I guess.
Yeah, it's true.
Had a lot of posts, apparently, on the Established Facts.
I know, right?
Gracious.
Our Facebook fans are really, really getting into it.
Absolutely.
I'm glad to see that. And we got a bunch of new fans and so forth after a few of us got back from the Fear the Con 5 out in St. Louis. I think that was a great success. Wouldn't you agree, Derek?
Oh, totally. It was a fantastic time. Great people. And we raised a lot of money, $1,026 for charity.
Nice.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's awesome.
Yep.
That is awesome.
Not to mention, I know we crowned the first Fear the Competition winner,
yes.
Which was very entertaining, our first attempt at the Pathfinder Society, which I tell you what, that's a fun process. I've never, ever been inside an established game like that, so... that whole world is something I'm not used to, and then running it for the first time that was fun.
Did you have anybody do their t-shirt reroll?
I did. And I think you had the same guy, the same family.
That's a really cool concept.
It is,
and you only get it once per game, don't you?
If you have out of the list of Pathfinder approved t-shirts. There's a certain set, one that's representing each of the different factions, and then a couple of other ones. If you actually are wearing and or we were cool with having, if you actually had your shirt, you have the right once per sit-down session to get a reroll.
Yeah.
That's sweet.
Yeah. The first time I saw a guy do that, it was one of the local game stores here, Arsenal Game Room. They were playing PFS, Pathfinder Society stuff.
Right.
And there was a guy wearing it. Is it... what is it, the Year of the Phoenix shirt or whatever the Phoenix shirt is?
The Ruby Phoenix.
The Ruby Phoenix shirt. Yeah, the Ruby Phoenix. They were wearing the Ruby Phoenix shirt, and he slapped his Ruby Phoenix logo, and he immediately took a reroll with his DM. And I was like, that is a really
that's awesome.
That's a fun concept. Like it, and it promotes tons of merch.
They've made a big deal out of the Ruby Phoenix this year. Their Ruby Phoenix tournament, I guess, is what they've really been focusing on this last round of Pathfinder Society things, and it went really well. I mean, I got the module, and it's a cool module.
Yeah,
it's a pretty interesting story. So
sweet.
So I guess, Don, that's going to lead us pretty well into our versus topic.
Absolutely, we have a really fun versus topic for everybody, and it the title is going to kind of throw you. Some people may get it, some people may not, but the title of our versus topic is Cake or Death. And what that refers to, not just the comedian who came up with that phrase, but
Eddie Izzard.
Eddie Izzard.
I don't care about name dropping. We're a nonprofit.
Yeah, but the concept
it's like
of,
you know, Eddie Izzard.
Yeah,
so,
right. Well, you know,
seriously.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, he's a close personal friend.
Then why isn't he on the show?
I don't.
Seriously, Dumber.
By close personal friend, I mean I subscribe to his YouTube channel.
Okay, I was going to say, I'm pretty sure I would bump myself from the show in order to have Eddie Izzard on here.
Yeah. That'd be so funny.
Yeah, it would.
He would but not fit in with us, though.
Yeah.
He'd fit in with Derek, maybe, but.
Oh, wow. So anyway, what the versus topic alludes to is Cake being, as a player, someone who prepares themselves for some sort of a strategic action plan and then tries to execute that plan to the actual, you know, the way that they put it together, the procedure that they put it together with, or Death being you just charge right in and, you know, kick in the doors, smash monsters in the face, and potentially die. But that's basically the concept. Are you, as a player, are you more of the I want to sit down and prepare my scheme, or are you the I want to just bash faces in, you know, uncontrollably? So, we'll start with Jeremy.
I'd say it depends on the character, but for the most part, I am a planner. I like sitting back next to the guy, whoever I'm scheming with, and whispering.
So you like Cake?
So you're a caker.
Like Cake.
Okay.
All right. Josh?
You know, I'm not going to be a fence sitter on this because I'm going to say Cake. But when it comes to cons, I'm definitely going to say Death. Because who the hell cares? It's a con. Yeah. Except for Derek's game. I will say that because now that I've established in that game and
but
spent
it's
whatever.
It's not really a con game at that point.
Well, at this point,
con game, but
when
it doesn't
you,
feel
when you
like
play the same con game in a continuing storyline year after year, it just becomes a character you only get to visit once a year.
It's true.
The first year, it was a Death.
Well, character. Yeah, because we didn't even know who this guy was.
Yeah, the years after was it's Cake.
But yeah, most of the time, I'm going to have to go with Cake. Yeah, it just what happens to me most of the time with the character I play Cake.
Derek?
Well, I would actually have to say Death. I have been in a number of games where people have planned for 2 hours this complicated raid, and the entire plan gets tossed out within the first 5 minutes. And so in order to just skip over the unnecessary boredom of trying to figure out the best way of attacking a castle or a gunship or something, excuse me, just go in there and deal with it. That's typically how I play my Star Wars character, Chupa, is I just say, you know what, let's just run in there, throw some syringes and figure out what happens later.
It's true.
So,
Anton?
Well, for me, it's Death. I look at plans and go, meh. And just kind of take what comes and just, meh, have fun.
Well, I think that over time, we've learned that most of the time making a plan doesn't ever work, but you still feel better about yourself having done so.
We have had the saying for years.
I know.
You want to make God laugh. Make plans.
But with our rule set, you know, rule number one, don't die.
Don't die. Rule number two, don't die.
Don't die. And rule number three is make a plan, throw it out the window, and if there are any other questions,
refer back to rule number one.
Right. So, keep it simple, of course.
Yeah. I would have to say I am a much more Cake style character, or player, I should say, from my characters. There are occasions, one of the games that I'm playing in right now is the 3.5, Dungeons & Dragons 3.5 Expedition to Castle Ravenloft, and I play a Dwarven Barbarian Battle Rager, and very much a Death character. There's very little planning in his mindset. It's usually, you're a big bad nasty, and you're hurting my party members, so I'll just drink this bottle of full strength while I still have my mental faculties, and then I'll rage out, and then I'll just, you know, rape face with the Dwarven War Axe. But for the most part, a lot of the characters that I play and have played are more of the kind of characters, even if I don't sit down like a whole long list of like procedures of how I want to execute certain things, I'm definitely a lot more calculating in the way that I execute my actions when I play a character. And I know we made reference to yesterday we were talking to our friend John Pettit, and we kind of talked about this a little bit just to kind of have a little bit of fun and some brainstorming. But was it Mikey Mason who made the comment that as a player, you are playing a hero? And
it was Tracy Hickman.
Yeah. That's right. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Not to give credit where credit's not due. Sorry, Mikey. But
he'll get over it.
Yeah. But basically, you're playing this supernatural hero. You know, on par with that of the ancient Greek heroes like Hercules and Achilles and people like that. And your job is to kick in doors and smash faces and, you know, shoot everybody and then ask questions later, kind of attitude. And I made the comment that though that may be true in a larger sense of, you know, a large majority of heroes probably do that. You know, you've got guys like Hercules who have, you know, great strength and they fight things head on, and Achilles who's an amazing warrior who does the same. But then you have Greek heroes like Perseus, who typically, you know, if you've ever seen Clash of the Titans or even the newer Clash of the Titans movie, Perseus is always he is always trying to use strategy in everything that he does. When he goes to fight Medusa, he doesn't run headlong into battle. He uses ambush tactics. He uses, and then after he kills her, he uses the advantage of having killed her to kill an even greater beast, being the Kraken. And so it's, to me, I feel like you can be just as effective as a hero with preparing your assault and then executing it as you can with, you know, with just, you know, kicking in the door and smashing face.
And one of the first big rules is keeping the plan simple.
Yeah.
I mean, the more you go into this process of plan building, the more likely it's going to be overly complex and just, you know, fail.
Don't be a barbarian who spends an hour talking tactics because your party will throw you into the dragon and then kill it in three rounds,
there,
right, Mikey?
Go. Yeah.
It's true. You got to take a character approach that fit. But you're going to run into those. I mean, your barbarians, your fighters. Your fighters are different. Your barbarians, especially your, you know, raging barbarian types. Yeah. You know, they're not really there.
Throw caution
planning.
To the wind.
Yeah, they're there to just kill things. I mean, that's what they're designed to do. Your monsters. A lot of the monsters you face in role playing games, you see the same things in RPGs on video games. You see them even in the military type games or whatever. There's a certain level of difficulty where it's just, I need to shoot anything that's a problem.
Yeah.
And then once
you got start, like your assault character, which is like, you know, just run and gun. And
but then as you go up in difficulty, and the same thing kind of applies for tabletop role playing, I guess you could say. Those of us with more experience can sometimes throw more planning in, try and be more tactical about things. And the same thing happens in a video game. As it gets more difficult, they become more tactical.
Yeah.
And you don't know where they're coming from. So the same thing applies there.
You have to adapt to the surroundings.
So you almost or get forced into a cake situation, which isn't that sad to say, getting forced into cake? Right. I think Gabriel Iglesias would have a problem with that.
Yeah, I don't think really anybody on this show is ever forced into cake. I think it's more of just a reluctant submission.
Yeah. Is it me or is the host trying to say we have a bit of a weight problem?
I don't know what you're talking about. I was saying we have a bit of a cake problem.
That's probably very true. Stop it, Ragar. Really? Just stop it.
Hey, you're like half the idiot.
I was about to say, you weigh about as much as my leg. Jeez, you and my wife.
They share a third stomach.
So true.
Yes, true.
So, I guess I can spawn even more of a question on that. The current movies and so forth that you see, especially, I know Postcards from the Dungeon, their last episode talked about the Avengers, and they looked at all the different characters and how they played their special roles and this, that, and the other. Mm-hmm. And now this, I will claim spoiler alert, because this is still a new thing.
And I will also say that I just listened to that episode, and I loved the spoiler alert that they added there. If you have not seen this movie, we are warning you, spoiler alert, please turn off this episode, see the movie, and then come back and revisit or something like that.
It was so funny.
I thought it was great.
But they focused on each position that each hero played. Because, right. I mean, you go everywhere from this god that is Thor,
to a guy with godlike strength like the Hulk,
all the way down to to Hawkeye and Black Widow, who are just crazy spies, and even Captain America, who may be strong, but you're not going to see him go up against that giant flying ship coming in. But the thing, if you notice, each of them have different tactics going into play. The Hulk is death all the way.
He's mainly a barbarian.
They did a fantastic job with that.
You have Hulk Smash versus the Black Widow, who will sit and play, let you play on her emotions until she gets the information out of it.
Yeah.
Oh gosh, she was so hot in that lather too.
I loved her character. It was great.
It was great.
Yeah, I'm sure you loved her character.
Hey.
Yeah.
Look, I am a big fan of Scarlett Johansson. I will not deny that whatsoever.
And his wife knows it.
Yes, she does. And there's nothing wrong with that. She did a heck of a job in the part. But you see it even in that type of a movie, that each one plays their own role, but each hero has their own stance. I think that's kind of where this comes into play as well. In a movie like that, do you prefer watching Cake or Death?
Yeah. I would have to say...
that is a tough question.
The testosterone side of me loves death, loves it in all of its fiery, explosive goodness.
Oh yes. But,
however,
now is it fiery, explosive Joss Whedon style or Michael Bay style? There are the two different styles going on.
I don't know. An explosion to me is an explosion.
Okay, fair enough.
Gigantic flame ball. I was a big fan of the Lethal Weapon series too, if that tells you anything. And Die Hard.
You know what? I think most buddy cop movies is a cake and death team. Yeah. I'm pretty sure that's how it works.
Yeah.
That would make sense.
So except for Bruce Willis in Die Hard, he's kind of his own cake and death character.
Yeah, but was he really a buddy cop? He was just himself, wasn't he?
Yeah, he wasn't really a buddy to anybody. but anyway.
Except the kid.
I had a lot of enjoyment. I will say one thing that I really enjoyed about that movie in its cake or deathness, if that's really a conjugal phrase I can put
we can
out
make
there.
It up.
Yeah,
it's coined.
That's right.
Remember, if you're going to say it wrong, might as well botch it.
Right?
Or butcher it.
Yeah.
Butcher it. Fine. But, look, I'm not a meat cutter, okay? I don't. Whatever.
Mike's dad is.
It's true.
Yeah, but he's not here.
He came up with a fact.
I think that what I really appreciated about the Avengers is kind of the graceful mix of both that they have in that movie. There's a lot of
get your cake and your death
too. My gosh, especially when in the beginning of the movie the beginning half of the movie.
Again, spoiler alert.
Well, yeah. All over the place.
Yeah,
for the next 20 minutes.
When Thor and Hulk are beating the ever-loving snot out of each other, I loved it. It was awesome. And then when they hint to, like, later on, like, okay, now that we've seen each other's strengths and weaknesses, they're kind of like partnering up, and then
the Hulk can't kill each other,
and then the Hulk kind of does that whole, buddy punch you in the shoulder and knocks him clear out of the camera shot, which I thought was great. But I really liked a lot of the cake style, puny god. A lot of the cake style touches that they put in there with the Black Widow being able to manipulate so many different people, even using it against Loki, which I thought was amazing.
And then
I really appreciated the emotions that a lot of the characters brought to that experience. So I think Derek's got something. Go for it, Derek.
As we're talking about movies, I was thinking about the type of action movies that I like. I like a lot of the martial arts type of movies. I don't know if I would consider them cake or death, but I like the movements, the choreography sort of the dance-like effects that they
typically
have.
Typically, I put them in cake. Because they're not, for the majority, most martial arts movies aren't throwing caution completely to the wind.
Now, there are the Beverly Hills
calculated.
Ninja.
There are the exceptions, but for the most part, they don't.
Mm-hmm. Last Samurai was certainly a cake.
Oh, yeah. Surprisingly good movie.
Uh-huh. Very good movie.
Back on the Avengers.
Aw.
Since Don hogged the mic and I didn't get a chance
to. Yeah, I hope you've seen the movie, Jeremy.
I have.
Okay. For me, Don said, I love death in that whole aspect of throw it out there and just throw caution.
I have psychiatrists for stuff like that.
But.
Yeah. Unfortunately, Dr. Deb is not one.
But what I have to say, though, is the inner sense that I want a series to continue wants cake.
Yeah.
True.
You want to see death, but you want cake so that it stays going.
Yeah.
So you have more death.
For the most part.
But I wouldn't consider like a movie like the Transformers that be cake at all.
No.
I can't imagine Battleship having any cake, but I haven't seen it.
It made $50 million, and it was a $200 million movie.
Yep.
It's been considered a flop. So.
Good. And
if you're going to do that, go. I don't remember. I think it was Mike who said it, that basically you just need to make it so the aliens are controlling people and actually make it more like the game Battleship.
Do it well and make it 1940s and then have it actually be a sea battle.
Oh, here's a question.
You could just skip that whole movie and never even make it.
Right.
What about Pitch Black?
Oh,
cake or death?
Man, that's a good question. Have you seen Chronicles of Riddick?
No, I have not.
Oh man.
Okay, Derek, well then you can just stay out of this conversation.
We will have a Riddick. Hey, Derek, we'll have a Riddick marathon when you come home.
So what we're saying is they're good.
Yeah,
they're you know, and
really, so, okay,
they're very good. And yeah.
I'm surprised you haven't seen it.
Yeah.
I heard someone on another podcast, either Kicked in the Dice Bags or Fear the Boot, who was commenting on how they didn't really like it. May not have been either one of those. I listened to like 10 different podcasts at a time, so it's hard for me to remember everybody who says something. But somebody was saying that they really didn't like the Riddick series. I was like, oh, crazy. That is such an awesome series.
Props to Vin Diesel, a former gamer himself.
Oh, who has, if you haven't gotten a chance to read it, I have a copy of it. The 30th anniversary of the Dungeons and Dragons, which came out like forever ago.
Yeah.
But he actually has a foreword in that book.
Oh, neat.
And it's a very, I've actually used that book as a legitimate source for public speaking presentation on Gen Con.
But anyways, with Pitch Black, that's a good question, because especially in the beginning of that movie, because when we were discussing our alignments, Riddick was one of those ones that really plays both sides. Uh-huh. He's very almost chaotic evil in the first movie. Or even neutral evil, maybe. But as the movies transition, he works his way towards neutral and even a little bit towards good.
He really does alignment shift.
He does. And it's a really interesting... But when he is, you know, chaotic evil as it may be, he just kills... He kills... But he's also trying to save himself, which is why I leaned it more towards neutral evil.
He doesn't kill... The thing is, he doesn't kill indiscriminately.
No, he has reasoning.
Right. And even in... the first movie, his alignment transitions greatly from the beginning to the end of the movie.
Yeah.
Because in the beginning of the movie, all he wants to do is get out of the situation that he's in. And at the end of the movie, he actually is considerate to the life of other characters in the movie. So, I mean, though he probably may have definitely started out in a chaotic evil sense, I definitely think that...
Honestly,
he kind of transitions in that first movie, and then greater.
I think I'm going to claim that movie is death by cake.
Hey, I like that.
That is a really
because he's very cold and calculated. But when it happens, it's done. It's just you're dead. He jumps headlong in, and the guy's done. So
another movie I was just thinking of that is very much, I like that phrase, death by cake, is The Punisher.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I mean,
it was
the whole movie. Did you say it wasn't a great movie?
I said it was an all right movie.
It was an all right movie.
Which one, the original or the remake?
The remake.
Not 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 they made Warzone two of them,
not
whatever.
Warzone. Yeah, the one that Kevin Nash
one.
Was in.
The first one.
Dolph Lundgren.
No.
No, not that one.
No. The one that
I will break you.
I don't know if the one with Dolph Lundgren in it was a Marvel movie, but the Marvel Punisher that had John Travolta and stuff like that in it, very much a death by cake movie because he, as soon as his family gets killed and he goes back to his home, I mean, it's from the beginning point of him returning to the end of the movie, it's nothing but prepared execution of those who assisted in the killing of his family. I mean, it is awesome.
I think it's pretty interesting that, you know, death is obviously what's come up in conversation here recently. Doesn't that lead us relatively into our discussion topic?
Absolutely, actually. Our discussion topic today is, it's on character death. And,
yes.
Yes, exactly. You know, several of us are familiar with having characters die or witnessing or being a part of a TPK or a total party kill for all of you noobs out there.
Or committing it.
Or committing a TPK, yes.
Oops.
Yep. But,
we're not a cult.
Yeah.
On Hail Rathmere.
Hail Rathmere. Grace Paylor.
Good Lord.
Sorry.
Brain wreck.
Yeah, I know, right?
Oh, wow. So our discussion topic on character death is kind of encircling a few different things. As a player, how do you respond to not only possibly your own character dying, but also a party member who may be essential to the party? You know, if you have your awesome cleric that's been running around with you for the last 8 levels and then something happens and they get into a situation they can't get out of, how do you respond to that? And then also, most of us have gotten a chance to run a game or experience kind of as a leader in a game. How do you respond to your players, and how do you use death as kind of a tool to help or hurt the party?
I think it depends on your experience as a gamer. When I was first gaming in Living Greyhawk, and they have some very, very brutal death mods there, I was a whiny bee when my character was just about to die. And after a while, you get to sort of say, you know what, I did spend a lot of time with this character, I did develop them a lot, but death is part of the game, and so you just have to get over it.
It can also be a motivating factor. I don't want to die with a character, but again, with our cake or death concept, if we know a game is we're planning on running it for a year, 2 years, something along those lines, you know, I don't want that to happen, but if it happens, it happens. It's part of the game. As a player, I've only lost a couple of characters, and most of the game masters that I've been with try to find some way to bring us back, or, you know, if it's a situation where I want to. Where I want to move on and do a different character, then we'll get the character killed off and we'll start a new character from there. And it's either killed off or move on. But as a game master, Don will get an opportunity to talk kind of where he sits on this, but I kind of agree with him on part of this. I really don't ever want to kill my players. I really don't. I really try not to. But the reality is that there's only a certain amount you can pad that. Some will fudge the numbers, some will not. Others, you know, if enough people die, I've even asked the party before, half the party got killed in one battle. I'm like, are you guys okay? I mean, and I remember Derek very clearly going, you know what? We are way too invested in this battle now. We are going to finish this. And sure enough, you guys did. So
my character died.
Yeah. And sure enough, we had some pretty bad guys that got killed.
That was a really good fight.
It was a good fight. And I was able to very storyline bring everybody back. It was a really cool way to introduce a character of old. But I think character death can really be used as an emotional aspect, too. I remember dying in the game, the Dragon Rider game and baby game thing that we played with Derek that actually, funny enough, has a big basis behind this tower that is evolving around these other two games that we're running now.
Oh, and, really?
Yeah, it does. Well, it is the tower. Oh. It's, that's the kind of the... We died in the tower.
Gotcha. Spoiler alert,
yeah,
Don.
Yeah, sorry.
yeah, thanks for the warning.
Well, you know, but that's about as much as you know about it.
No, I'm kidding.
But we're in this situation. We're in this emotional situation where, you know, with the Dragon Riders, it's you and this Dragon Rider, and the life is this dragon, and the life's being sucked out of you. And the only thing I remember more than anything is me as a writer, my dragon is panicking, not because he's dying, but because I'm dying. There's that, and it's like, oh my God, what? And sure, in that game, my dragon died because they have a dex of 10, and every time we rolled, they either lost 2 or 4 to dex, and after 3 rounds, they're done. You know, it's no big shock. But and when I survive and sitting there, and this dragon that has been so loyal to me is nothing but a stone statue now, It's very emotional because I didn't die, but someone so close to me did, and it's chilling now. And this happened almost 2 years ago.
Yeah.
From a storytelling perspective, I really really like the use of death when it's planned or thought out. And in order to initiate that, what I'd do is I'd communicate with the player and try to work out, okay, this is where we're at now. What I'd like to do is move us to a point where we might get here, and then I'd like to see perhaps your character die off, and then ask for permission. Is that okay? Can I do that for a story purpose? And give them some time to prepare for it, and maybe even get a secondary character built up so that that could be introduced. But, I mean, having that point to really drive in an emotional aspect to the story can be really powerful.
Yeah, it's when I was running that, I completely agree with you, Jeremy, that when I was running that dragon game, I was telling the players and beforehand throughout the entire campaign, I was alluding to the fact that they probably would not survive. And it's a very important contract with your players to let them know, this is what the lethality of this game is. Your character may die. Is that all right with you? And personally, as a GM, if a death is incredibly stupid, I'll walk it back or fudge the roll.
It's tough.
yeah. Totally. But if it happens during combat, you know, the player rolled poorly and the bad guy rolled well and there was a long battle for this and they just happened to die, like I tend to kill Josh's character a lot, I think that's okay. I think that in combat there has to be a level of expectation that there may be death. Otherwise, what's the point of combat?
Yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I think that what really validates the action in a game is the threat of possibly not being able to play that character ever again. You know, you have to balance the passion you have for that character for the preparedness of being able to execute whatever plan you do happen to have effectively. I can remember, and this kind of, I know this is not 100% on topic, but I think that it really contributes to what Jeremy and Derek have been talking about. I was running a game, it was actually the first game my wife had ever played in. I was running a game where she played it was a 3-5 game, she played a Wilder. And I remember Josh played in the game. I can't remember if Anton, you were in the game.
Okay.
I know Jeremy and Derek didn't get a chance to experience this, but her character in the game, this was the first role-playing game she'd ever gotten into. So I really wanted her to have a great time, and I really wanted to set a bar high enough so that she would want to continue to play role-playing games, because I love role-playing games, and I know that, you know, for the most part, it's really important for all of us as gamers to have other people we can game with. Otherwise, what's the point in us playing? And so I thought this would be a really cool opportunity for me to really get everybody in to this game. And what happened was, in her backstory, in her character development, she had a father who was a Scion.
Oh yeah, I remember this.
And if you know anything about the difference between a Wilder and a Scion from 3.5, just real quick, a Scion is someone who has practiced in the art of using their psionic mental abilities to conjure up powers and effects and things like that, where a Wilder is more of kind of someone who has power points and has the ability to use their powers, but it's more of a slapdash quilted version, if you will, like of different pieces and parts of different things.
It's the sorcerer of Scions.
Yeah, exactly. It's kind of the sorcerer of Scions. They kind of have a certain short list of things that they can accomplish, but they have a lot of really cool effectiveness in doing that. Anyway, her father is a Scion who kind of led her into running away because of how much he had pressured her into being the perfect psychic warrior of in a sense. And there came a point where she was able to confront her father, but it was in a combative sort of way. He was leading a group, like a raiding party of bad guys, fill in the blank bad guys, and in the midst of the battle, a couple of the characters killed her father. And up until this point, she had been seeking kind of she had kind of been seeking retribution and vengeance because of how she felt her father was treating her. But it was kind of that sense, like when in Star Wars, A New Hope, and I'm not going to give a spoiler alert because if you have not seen Star Wars, there is something wrong with you. But in the episode 4, the original Star Wars movie, Luke is constantly seeking the truth about who his family was and who his father was. And when he finally gets to the end of Return of the Jedi, the third original Star Wars movie, at his father's death is really when his father and himself finally get to the same plane of understanding, and they really identify with each other finally. But it's, you know, it's kind of like that bittersweet moment, because it's like you finally gotten a chance to look into your dad's eyes and he accepts you for who you are, but now he's gone. And that's what happened to her character. Was she was so it was such an intense battle, and then her father died, and then she realized that what had happened was not what she wanted at all. What she wanted was to have that acceptance with her dad, and she literally cried on the way home in my car because she was so upset that her – and I felt so proud of myself because I was like, this is awesome. Like, she has never played in a role-playing game, and she's playing – I mean, she's still in the mindset of her character, and it made me feel good that I was running it well for her, but it made me feel good that she was getting into it. And really enveloped herself in that character. And I think, kind of bringing it back to my point, I think that even if you don't have the death of a player, death in general can be such a stimulus for growth in your game that, you know, if you play it effectively, I think that there is a really strong emotional bond, just like what you were talking about as a dragon rider. Having your dragon that you had this bond with die in front of you while you were still riding it, I mean, that would be so intense as a player. Like, that's just such a cool feeling to know that you are attached to the game so close.
You just gave me an idea for the end game that I have. Oh,
all right,
man.
Well, so, I'm glad I could contribute. Awesome.
I've only had two deaths in characters over the years. One I caused myself because I caused one out of frustration. I suicided the character out of frustration because I was playing a character that was my Sunrunner.
Yeah.
I was playing a character that was not fully built. And I was trying to get information about the character so that I could actually properly play the character, and I was getting nothing. So at that point, I was just like, this character class is not done enough, and I suicided the character. That's the only one I had any kind of emotional tie to. The other character was
I was going to say, I think you had played that character for a little while before you got to that
point. Yeah,
I played
it probably 3 or 4 months before I got to the point where I was just like...
Which is a long time, considering we played like almost every night.
At the time.
I mean...
And the only other character that's died on me was P...
Because we all died.
Yeah, we all died, and that really didn't
that
have
was,
that really didn't have an emotional. I mean, it was a pain in the butt more than and an actual emotional attachment to.
Another aspect is the setting, the universe, and the system that you're using. For instance, I know some systems can be less forgiving than others. In particular, I think D&D has issues with the minus 10. Well, did you one hit and actually exceed the 10?
Right.
Which can be difficult to manage. Something about the Dark Heresy universe, which is a Warhammer 40K game, is they have a number of fate points that are attached to the character to illustrate that this character has been blessed, that they are
right.
destined for something greater. And that number of fate points, typically about 2 or 3, can be lost in the event that something happens and your character has died. So instead of letting the character die, you can say, I'm going to burn a fate point. I'm going to get rid of it forever. And, you know, we're going to do something, rewind time or something, or, you know, my God has blessed me that whatever was supposed to happen didn't.
Right.
And something like that's I think the level of forgiveness.
Destiny cool. points in Star
yeah,
Wars,
very
same
cool.
thing.
And like that rolls down into like what I was thinking just a minute ago. It also depends a lot on the campaign setting you're playing in, too, because in some games, death is just like, oh, well, it kind of happens. But in the others, you really do have an emotional tie. But also, I think it's the type of game you're playing. For example, our Dalfour game, death was used as a game mechanic and not actually as something overly meaningful. She wanted to reset the game.
I don't know if I would 100% agree with that, only because at the time of that reset, I was one of the first additional characters. Originally, the Dalfour game was just our friend Danielle and her husband John, and she was running the game for just him. And then Michael, our host, and I were the next two characters to actually get involved actively with that game. And we played that game before we did that first death. We had probably played that game, I think, for two and a half years.
We're talking two and a half years. We're talking at least three,
within
4
six
nights
months,
a week.
Josh and I joined, and then within
right.
3 months of that, Tony joined.
Right, and I can remember, and I think that the biggest difference with each, this is another thing that definitely is involved in this topic, how death affects each character individually, even if it's the same death. Because I can remember my character being very emotionally tied to what was getting ready to happen. We were getting ready to go. Basically, we were getting ready to go and fight our big boss fight. And I had been in during the game. Yeah, during the game, I had gotten married, Michael played my brother in the game. So it was like there was a lot of emotional ties because we knew that there was a big chance that we were not going to make it out. Obviously, that was not our goal, but we knew that in fighting this last guy, that there was a good chance that those characters would not make it out alive. And so we actually role-played our last night together before this big battle, and it was Michael and I's character, we actually sat down and literally wrote letters to our DM / our wives, basically, and had her read the letters. And she started crying in the middle of running the game because we were so emotionally attached to those characters because we'd been playing for so long. And we knew the imminent conclusion to this battle was most likely going to be our demise. Now, again, I agree. Yeah,
My side of that whole thing.
Yeah.
My character had no people.
Right, right.
I had no relationships in the game.
Right. And that's what I was getting ready to say. Every game's a little bit different for everybody.
Well, it's per character. And in that sense, you guys were more, it was more of a cake type of scenario there.
Right, absolutely. Absolutely. And I think what was amazing was, yes, we did end up, in the storyline, we did end up dying However, it was an opportunity for her to take those same characters and kind of what ended up happening is we ended up time jumping forward 2,000 years due to the intercession of some deific help. And basically we righted a lot of the things that had happened as an effect of us dying. And then we went, as soon as we were done accomplishing that goal, we got sent back to our original time frame and got a chance to do it all over again with the knowledge that we had gained and basically just beat the ever-loving poo out of him.
Apparently, even though I wasn't there.
Yeah, I wasn't there either, unfortunately.
Neither was I.
Yeah. By then, that was, I think that was like year 5 of 6.
Yeah.
And a lot of the original characters had, we had been, our actual, you know, IRL in real life lives were changing. And so a lot of the times we weren't there, we weren't able to get to every game. And so obviously as a player, things happen in your game that you can't alter or affect. And when we finally got back to playing on a regular basis with everyone else, we had like 15 people, like literally 15 people in the party, and there
wasn't
was
this all like double classes at this point?
It was like ridiculous.
Epic level gestalt characters.
Yeah,
last
it was
character
ridiculous.
Was 30.
Effectively, I was an 80th level character.
Holy cow!
because we had two total. 40, we had
42nd level gestalted.
Yeah. Yeah, 80 something. I don't.
It was
yeah,
we were
by the then. It was. By
the first
then
death
we were
was 42nd level. We were 33rd gestalted.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's right. And the nice thing is we kind of tied it all up to where basically the deific powers at the time were ready to retire. And basically were
the deities were like a retiring age.
Yeah. Like
were they going to like to Boca or something?
I don't. I guess
they had a private property.
I guess
set up
on
in
the
Celestia.
Plane of Celestia, there is a private club that most retired deities can go
retirement
to.
Retirement home,
and
for
so
deities only.
Basically
pastels and
yeah, and
it's like a Bally's for deities.
Yeah. And we had now the nice thing is we had kind of talked to like the DM knew that this was coming because she was ready to close the game up and tie off all the loose ends, and we were ready to do the same. Though we enjoyed our characters, it was getting harder and harder for us to be able to continue to play those characters, and harder for her to run, because obviously as a 32nd level gestalted, effectively a 64th level character, it's almost impossible for you to do anything against them. So we ended up like putting some deities voluntarily into retirement and usurping their domains and things like that, which was kind of neat. It was kind of a nod to us having played for so long, but
and Don, just to go back to the deity thing that you were talking about, I just have to go back to that. It's hilarious. It's like the deities were playing the game of life.
Yeah, essentially.
So what did you get? Oh, I went through college and I was a god, you know. Now I'm going to get 2 kids and retire.
Yeah. See, that's an interesting process. It's like, you know, you get out of high school, you go to college, maybe get married, become a god, then retire.
That's a good question. What happens to all the deities' kids?
Well, I don't know. It depends on the situation.
They can't all be eunuchs.
I think my favorite part about
they go to 32nd level gestalted.
I think my favorite part about the ending of that game though, had to be that everyone else was a deity except Dalfour, and Dalfour didn't know it. So like we were completely screwing with him. He may not even know it to this day. I don't know if you guys have talked about it or not, but
wow.
Anyways,
I thought it was funny that the game started with him and it ended with him, and yet at the end of it, he was like, I just want to retire and live with my family. I'm like, dude, I'm going to become a deity. That'd be awesome.
That'd be awesome.
I can go ahead and say that now.
Awesome.
It's funny. I remember being the monk deity that I was, having a monastery where they trained and kicking people in the nuts. I swear to God, that is exactly what we had.
Wow.
And then Mike and I's character, the brothers, we had our school of
towers.
Our towers of
magic
basically, sorcery.
Yeah.
It's weird. I mean you guys talk about this campaign a lot with some fondness, some question marks, but mainly because you've played it for a very long time.
Yeah.
Right around 6 years.
6 years. It's, you rarely get to see this in cons because, I mean, it's a one shot. Except for the oddball that I ran at Gen Con, that I run at Gen Con now, the Gen Con campaign, typically you're there one session, see this GM, see the players, probably will not play with them again. And so
definitely won't convince them to move to your city.
Yeah.
What was that?
Definitely won't convince your GM to move to your city.
Oh no, certainly not twice.
We should do that with the Jawas guy.
Oh, that'd be so stupid.
The scary part is we're trying to do it to John Pettit now.
Yeah, seriously.
That's not scary. Yeah.
If we can get John Pettit to move here, we're gonna be batting 1,000.
High five.
We're gonna start writing a book, How to Convert Your DM to a Resident.
Start getting commissions.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I think that players take a much different approach to player death at con games. I don't think that they are as concerned about it, but it turns into a weird situation because you, at the larger cons, you typically pay for each slot that you're a part of. So it's like, as a GM, I want to make sure they get their money's worth, but I also don't want to nerf it. And from their perspective, they're like, I don't care about this character, but I want to play long enough to feel like I got my money's worth.
Yeah. I did want to ask you, Derek, while you and Josh were at Fear the Con 5 in hanging out with all the awesome gamers out there.
Food guys.
Yeah. What was...
Go Booters.
Did you guys get a chance to experience any player death in your running and I mean, was it?
No.
Did you kill
killed
anybody?
A character?
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you did. The guy that died in a one shot from the composite longbow. he's the guy that ended up winning the competition.
Could,
if you
if
remember,
you could only
that's awesome.
See the realization.
He died.
Of what happened,
he died and still won.
Well, yeah, because he got.
You hear
voted.
That, ladies and gentlemen? Death still has second chances. Yes.
Well, what happened was is he got shot with a composite longbow because this the
I'm glad that you remember this.
I wasn't even at the table because I heard about this. I heard about it. They walked into the room, and like as soon as he walked in the room, the main bad guy just completely nailed him with a critical on a composite longbow and one-shotted him. Just he was down. And the party voted for him to be the winner, so thus he made it to the finals.
That's cool.
That's cool.
That's very cool.
It was – now that you reminded me, okay, I was drinking a little bit, but not that much.
Uh-huh.
Because they have free beer there.
Oh, yes. So, Danger Brewery, thank
Danger
you very
Brewery.
Much.
Danger Brewery, yeah, man.
Danger Brewery.
Danger Brewery.
In Indianapolis.
Yeah, place. And they need to hurry up and, like, have... I was driving around the other day looking for their place because in my head, I'm like, oh, obviously they're a microbrewery. They would have their own facility, right? No, I'm pretty sure they're just, you know, hanging out in their basement making beer. And I was like, well, I need to find their basement, apparently.
Yeah.
Where's the cellar that I can go and hang out in? So.
KC Campbell, if you're listening, you need to let us know we want some beer.
Yeah. Seriously.
You can even come and game with us.
Yeah, I'm too cool with that.
Yeah, please. They're really cool guys.
Just don't drink and drive.
Exactly.
Yeah, drive
you
and
can
then
drink.
Drink
and game, you can't drink and
that's
drive.
That's right. That's right.
So, I did actually kill somebody. It wasn't, I guess I didn't remember it because it wasn't like torturous and lots of death and bleeding. It was sort of a one shot.
As you prefer.
Boring. So, But I think he took it really well, and I think that that's typically what happens with con games. It's a little bit weirder with society because you do actually invest time in you invest time in your character because you play it over multiple sessions. So it's a little bit different than a one-shot con game. So,
all right. Well, I think that's probably going to wrap things up for us today.
Yeah.
Well, I did. As we are closing, I do have a new established fact. But
oh, do you?
I would also, while I am the interim host, I did want to take a couple just quick minutes
Is it time for our cheap plug segment?
Yes, to do our cheap plug segment. So go ahead and do the Demery scheduled cheap plug.
Fantastic. If you would like to find
this scheduled.
If you would like to purchase some fantastic merchandise to support the Established Facts, please go to cafepress.com/castingrobot. Also, we would love to hear your input and comments and so forth on our Facebook group at The Established Facts. Or you can visit us at theestablishedfacts.blogspot.com. Please also search for us in iTunes if you need to. And if you have any questions, please do not fear to send us messages and so forth on Facebook.
We need to start accepting Bitcoins, too. Bitcoins.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. Does anybody have any upcoming events? I know that there, for any of those who are interested, I will find the link and I will link it to our Facebook page. There is a small 2 or 3 day con going on in July up in Fort Wayne, Indiana. And you know, it's always awesome to get new blood up there, and I will definitely have the link on there as soon as we get.
Also,
probably
Origins
soon as we get
is
the
coming
recording.
Up in June. Yeah. I know that
that's in Ohio.
Yes,
yeah,
in Ohio.
Origins is in Ohio. I believe it's in Columbus, isn't it?
Yeah, I will say that as far as I know, none of us are going to be represented at Origins, and I do apologize.
No, but Origins is a blast. I would go to it at least once.
Yeah, and I know that Plaid Hat Games and Dice Tower are usually at Origins, too, so big shout out to those guys, and anytime you guys want to come on over to Naptown and play with the Established Facts crew, we'd love to have you. So, don't look at me like that, Derek. Naptown, what is that?
Yes, that's a nickname of Indianapolis.
That's right.
You know,
Indianapolis, Naptown.
I was like, is it old people town where they have to take like the
nap?
Exactly.
We have scheduled nap time. Siestas.
See, my wife is enjoying it right now.
Scheduled nap time.
That's right. Citywide.
That would be awesome. I'll vote for the next mayor that says that. I am scheduling a siesta.
Yeah.
I have to pimp out my Gen Con event that I'm running this year. I am running an incredible 7 event. So look for those under Pelican Project LLC. Derek Knutson is the GM for that. I won't go through all the titles because that would just be boring.
It's probably one of the easiest ways to find it is look for the game called Lost Religion.
Well, yeah, but there's that's why he said Pelion Project.
You can find others through the links, though. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah, I mean, there are 7 of them. I'm also going to be playtesting my new system out there, too.
The dual world system, is that right?
The dual world system, yep. So, come to Indy over the summer and play some games.
Speaking of which, D&D 5.0, I want to say, just went public beta.
Yeah, the public playtest is out there. You know, I got a link for that and cannot download it. I can't find it. So I got to give Wizards some trouble for that. But yes, D&D Next is currently
Please tell me they're not calling us D&D Next.
No,
please tell me they're not calling it that.
They haven't given a name to it yet, but D&D Next is the name of the project right now. So that's what this is. It's the D&D Next playtest.
Code names.
Yeah, so the playtest is out and running. I've heard some different things about it, but I have no details other than you can get to the playtest if you go to wizards.com and look up D&D Next. Mm-hmm. There is a way to sign up for it. That's all I know about it.
And, of course, coming this August, between the 16th and the 19th of August here in Indianapolis, Indiana, we will be hosting Gen Con 2012 at the Indiana Convention Center. Definitely get on to not only the Gen Con website at gencon.com and register and get your 4-day badge and all your event tickets and stuff like that.
At genconreg.com.
That's right. But also get on to their Facebook group. They've got I believe it's Gen Con Indy Facebook group. They've got a lot of really cool people who are on there. Usually they've got a couple like actual Gen Con officials that are on there. So if you have legitimate questions about Gen Con, where to go, what to see, what attractions you can check out, where to get a hotel room if you're staying out of town.
They also comment about some of the apps or things available to make the logistics of navigating downtown.
Yeah,
and they make small announcements from the different game companies.
Right.
So
absolutely.
It's a good thing to be a part of, even if you're a veteran.
Yeah, and I'm a part of that group and a couple other local gaming groups from Indy. And so there's a lot of really cool stuff going on with them. But definitely check them out on Facebook and on GenCon.com. With that, we will get into our last closing business. As we established in our last episode, original or established world, Lady Mance or Bromance. See, there we go.
There you go. Butcher
your,
it.
Yeah, your game is only as good as your vocabulary. And today, we have established not just one, but two established facts.
Ooh.
One of them is kind of a holler back to an old inside joke, so I hope you all get this. The first one is, whether you enjoy cake or a long or long for epic death, Razmir trumps any host. And the second, yeah. And the second is,
if you have not played the Masters of the Living God module from Pathfinder, look it up. That whole trilogy with the Razmirian cult is just priceless. If you go about it thinking of Razmir, the half god that's not really a god, so entertaining.
And this is a tribute established fact to our missing host for the day. But this goes out to you, Mike. When you eliminate your host, do you usurp his power? All right, that is it for the established
facts. You take what you kill.
That's right, you take what you kill.
Yeah,
that's right.
Can I loot his body?
Can you loot his body? Yes.
Absolutely. Can I have your stuff, right, Tony?
Nice throwback to Chronicles of Riddick.
Yeah, exactly.
Stay tuned next time. We have a very, very fun episode coming up next.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. And please don't forget, leave your comments on our Facebook page, The Established Facts on Facebook. Group, blah, blah, blah. Okay. So, yeah, all right.
And Bart.
Yep. Everybody good?
Yep.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Cheers.